Devine, and I'm here to talk about my Mark II Escort, 1978 Mexico, known as the Mexorcist. I've owned the car for about 27, 28 years now. Started off life, bought it off of a friend for £600, believe it or not. I don't think you could do that now. He ran the car as stock, as standard, well, with the 2.150s on it, so a fairly standard classic Ford for many, many years. So I've been building the car now for 7-8 years. It had originally started off to build the car just as like a completely stock looking sleeper look, so but with an awful lot of power. So started off with put a Cosworth YB in it, standard T5 box, lowered it down a little bit more, put 7-inch rims instead of the 6.5s that you have on it, and then ran it up to Santa Pod and got about 4 or 5 runs in and then blew it up. So it came back and it was like, okay, well, what do we do? Do I change the turbo? Okay, bigger turbo. And then that involved cutting out the inner wings, and okay, it needed 6-linked because it was tramping at the back. And then it sort of snowballed a little bit from there. Under the engine bay, what we've got is a Cosworth YB, but it's an all aluminium block. The only part that's original now left out of my engine, which went wrong at Santa Pod, is the head, the crank, and the exhaust camshaft. That's the only thing that's actually left of the original engine. The rest has all been replaced. So Julian Godfrey built up the engine for me. So high compression, 9-to-1, run a Nortec twin scroll manifold with a Borg Warner turbo, 1000cc injectors, a custom plenum from Arno in Sweden. This was a bit of a late change, and it did change an awful lot about the car, because having to make all of the hard pipes and try and hide everything under the engine bay to make it look as simple as possible was then a nightmare, because everything had moved forward. One of my friends kept on saying to me, do a sequential box. And I was like, okay, yeah, fine. So a sequential box then went in. And then at the time, you'll see the stickers on the side of the FPE. I was following Mike FPE on Instagram. I didn't really know him back then, but he posts an awful lot of Group 5, Group 2 cars from like the 70s. And I kept on seeing the Group 2 cars, and I was like, that's different. So if I can build something road going, looking like that, that's gonna be amazing. It's gonna be, because if I'd built a stock one, yeah, it would have an awful lot of power, it'd be a great sleeper, but you'd go to a show and it's like, yeah, there's an orange Mark II Mexico, or look, that's next to a green Mark II Mexico, they're all the same. There's nothing wrong with that, it's just not really me. So I'd seen that, so I found somebody that could supply me the Zaxby kit. And once that kit was then put on, it was then, right, this is right. And then it was okay, get some weight out of the car. So it was carbon boot, carbon bonnet. It's got a carbon roof, so it's not a skin on the top of the roof, it's actually a carbon roof. And my friend who helped me with all the fabrication, Colin, he was stood up on a ladder with the air saw in his hand. He's like, are you sure you want to do this? I'm like, yeah. He goes, he laughed and said, just as well these aren't worth much before we chop the roof off. And that's what an awful lot of people are like, yeah, but you call it, it's not really a Mexico, is it? I'm like, yeah, well, the Mexico. I remember I posted a picture of it at Santa Pod before, and people are like, that's not the same car. And I'm like, yeah, that's the same car. And they're like, what, you cut up an original Mexico? Yeah. I've owned the car for 27 years, as I said. I'm not going to buy another one. I'm not selling it. So what's the value? I'm not somebody that's going to store it in a dry shed and watch it gain value and then sell it on the open market. So that's not what it's about. But a lot of the things that I've done to the car has been, you know, an awful lot of 3D printing. There's CAN bus throughout the car. It's a total resto mod. It runs a BMW M5 charge cooler system in it. It's not intercooled, it's charge cooled. So if you turn it on without the engine running and you press the accelerator, you hear it. It's running like a washing machine. It's like really a funny experience. So it was all trying to use a lot of modern technology that companies have spent millions and billions developing, and adapting that into a 78 Mark II Escort. So the 3D printing, it was like, opened up something new for me, and that was sort of like a bit of a lockdown skill. It was like learning how to use 3D software. You know, I started off, I could hardly draw a circle in it, but then that went ahead, and it was scan like the make my own rear lights out of like resin infusion and filament printing. So, and then obviously learning how to carbon skin stuff and do everything myself. It's, people look at it and think, well, what, you know, what have you actually made? And it's like, okay, well, all of it. So the steering wheel, quick release, is all 3D printed. So obviously apart from the wheel itself. So, and obviously I made it a little bit fun. You've got like a, you know, launch control stroke anti-lag. You've got a little forklift truck for like lifting up the, because it's on air cups at the front. But you can turn on off the headlights, you can flash, you can indicate. And then you've got the paddle shift. So, and then you have the screen on the top that gives you basically all of the information. Yeah, so on the back of the steering wheel, so we have obviously like a Sparco quick release, and then in here is like the electronics that obviously I've picked up and tore onto canvas and onto a quick release. But the whole back plate, the whole buttons, the whole idea behind it was to put all of the controls for the car onto one place, rather than having buttons down on the dashboard. So everything is at your fingertips, you know, and then we have variable rate steering. So, but I designed all of this. So it's a bit of a challenge to think, okay, well, how can I make that work? And plus it's great fun. So, and people are like, how much was that? You know, how much were you making one for? It's like, well, I'm not making another one because they're a nightmare. So it's enough doing it once. The steering wheel is all 3D printed. The software has all been written by me for the screen and the buttons and the paddle shift, which goes through to an air shifter, which means you can then flat shift. Because one of the original ideas I mentioned about the drag racing was I actually blew up racing a friend, as you do, and he's only just got his car back on the road for doing the same thing 7 years ago. He had Mark IV Supra. So he spent an absolute fortune on that as well. But the idea behind the flat shifting was so that what I ultimately wanted to build was a 10-second car. And that sounds very, very fast and furious, but it was, and I do know that I could have probably built a 10-second car for an awful lot less money, but it's what I wanted to do. And half of the fun of building a car is the enjoyment of actually building it. It's actually quite terrifying to actually now drive it, because I've been building it for so long. It's a little bit different. It was a little bit of fun. And that's part of the thing whenever you're building a car is to, I didn't build this to impress anyone. I built this for me. Just a bit of fun. Can't stop it, they know when I'm a level. They know when I'm discrediting this, regardless what they take me. Taking it back into the beginning when I'm just killing them with the battle rats. Be rapping on them when I'm coming, they can handle that. So homie, independent boy, I'm busy, buddy, help me. I did it on my own, but you can't tell me no way. Wait, that's my pride talking.